Happy Sabbath, church, and welcome to the final Sabbath of this month in August. As you know, many of our schools are back in session. Many parents are doing distance learning, but we are here to pause during the craziness of all this week and worship. We want to remind you that we do have our Sabbath schools meeting at both churches, at Orange and at Anaheim, both at 9 o'clock. So if you are members of either one, we encourage you to come and attend and be part of the worship experience. We also want to remind you that next week is communion service. And if you look at on the newsletter link, there's also a YouTube that you can click on and watch how to make the communion bread and what ingredients are there as well. So please make sure to check that and remember, next week is communion. We want to remind you also that our food pantries and our food banks are open still. Here at Anaheim, which we are recording, it's at 5 o'clock on Wednesdays. And anytime you need at the Orange Church, just give us a call and we'll be sure to be there. Please remember also, while we are doing these online recordings, please remember Advent is giving at both your local churches, and you can make sure you just sign in to your own login and donate there. We hope you have a blessed Sabbath, and thank you for joining us here. God bless.
For our opening hymn, we're going to be singing number 103, Our God, Our Help.
Time for our children's story. So if you want to have the little ones come on up to the computer or whatever screen you're watching on, and we have a really cool experiment for them. So today I want to talk to you guys about fear. Have you ever been afraid before? I know I have. I am terrified of a few things. Several things actually, but one of them is snakes. I'm scared of needles. I'm scared of a whole bunch of other things too. And I imagine that you guys also have some things that you are afraid of. Well, great news is that we do not need to let fear control us. In the Bible, it says, to be strong and courageous, do not be afraid. So, what does that tell us? It tells us that God does not want us to be afraid. I have here a cute little experiment to illustrate fear. So we're gonna pretend this water here is fear. I'm gonna prove that it is just plain water. I'm gonna drink some. This is normal water. And we are going to pour it into this cup. So when we have fear in our lives, it's kinda like this water. If something we're afraid of comes into our life, we meet a situation that makes us afraid, we deal with Maybe some animals that make us afraid, or something is going on in life. There's changes happening, and things make us scared of what's going on around us. And so, the Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear." This means that fear does not come from God. Fear happens in this world around us when there are things that we are afraid are going to hurt us or make us uncomfortable in some way. I know that coming up here, we have school starting and there's some more big changes going on in the world around us. And sometimes we might be a little afraid. Afraid of the change, afraid of going back to school, or whatever the situation is. But there is one cure for fear, and it is called prayer. So when we face things that we are afraid of, what we need to do is pray. Pray for God to give us courage to conquer our fears. So let's pray right now. Dear Jesus, be with us when we are afraid. Give us courage to conquer our fears and help us to remember that you love us so much and that you are way bigger than any of our fears. We thank you for all that you do. We love you so much. Amen. Okay, so when we pray that prayer, we pray for Jesus to give us courage to conquer our fears. Our fears go completely away because he gives us courage. So isn't that amazing? The water's all gone. It's not coming out at all. So just like how the water disappeared, our fears disappear because God gives us courage to face them because he is bigger than all of our fears. One more text for you, and it is from Isaiah 41, verse 10. Another amazing text about how we should not be afraid. It says, "Do not be afraid, for I am with you." We do not have to be afraid, because Jesus and God is bigger than all of our fears, and he is with us and loves us very much. Let's pray one more time. Dear Jesus, be with these children throughout the week. Help them to face their fears and have courage to tackle whatever world may throw at them. We thank you for all that you do. Thank you for loving us. We love you so much. Amen.
As we prepare to approach our Lord in prayer, let's open our hearts in singing hymn number 671, "Now, Dear Lord, As We Pray."
Those that are able, please kneel. For others, just bow your head, please. Heavenly Father, loving Creator and Master of our universe, it's so great to be here this morning in your sanctuary. Although it feels strange not to see our members sitting in the pews, during this pandemic that turned up our lives upside down, we come to worship you together using technology. But we have so many reasons to bring you thanks and be grateful for. First of all, for Jesus, our Savior, that died for our sins. Please forgive us for our transgressions. We are so grateful for your continued protection from the virus and for guiding us during these challenging times. We thank you for all your blessings in our daily lives. Our church, the entire world, goes through an unprecedented crisis seen only a few times in history. People suffer with illnesses caused by the virus. Many grieve from the loss of loved ones, and many others with financial challenges due to unemployment and loss of income. Please hear our prayers and help us help those affected by this tragedy and those affected by natural disasters like the hurricane in Texas and Louisiana, like the fires in California, and all the other places that they suffer from social unrest. These last few months were filled with worries and anxiety. There is so much unknown that lies ahead. A lot of questions and a lot of stress. Please, God, bless us with your calm and peace that only you can provide. Fill us with the courage and compassion that we need to face the challenges that come our way. Give us the power and wisdom. Give us the best of ours to give our best of ourselves to those that are in need, and make us truly be tools in your hands to make this a better world. Give us direction, purpose, perseverance, and lead us to your kingdom. We pray for all this in the name of our Jesus Christ. Amen.
Many of us can think back to these vows. Yes? So, I'll stand here with Robert and Miranda on my right, and Amanda and Norma, who's here for support, on the left. And I'll ask you, do you believe in God the Father, His Son Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, a unity of three co-eternal persons?
Yes.
Amen. Number two, do you accept the death of Jesus Christ on Calvary as the sacrifice for your sins? And do you believe that through faith in His shed blood, you are saved from sin and its penalty?
Yes.
Amen. Number three, renouncing the world and its sinful ways, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? And do you believe that God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven your sins and given you a new heart?
Yes.
Amen. Number four, do you accept by faith the righteousness of Christ, recognizing Him as your intercessor in the heavenly sanctuary? And do you claim His promise to strengthen you by His Spirit dwelling in you, so that you may receive power to do His will?
Yes.
Amen. Number five, do you believe that the Bible is God's inspired word and that it constitutes the only rule of faith and practice for Christians?
Yes.
Amen. Number six, do you accept the Ten Commandments as still binding upon Christians? And is it your purpose, by the power of Christ dwelling in you, to keep His law, including the fourth commandment, which discusses the observance of the seventh day of the week as a holy Sabbath to the Lord?
Yes.
Amen. Number seven, is the soon coming of Jesus the blessed hope in your heart? And are you determined to be personally ready to meet the Lord and to do all in your power to witness to His loving salvation and by your life and your word help others to be ready for His glorious appearing?
Yes.
Amen. Number eight, do you accept the biblical teaching of spiritual gifts? And do you believe that the gift of prophecy is one of the identifying marks of the remnant church?
Yes.
Amen. Number nine, do you believe in the organization of a church as God's will? And is it your purpose to support the church by your tithes, your offerings, your personal effort, and your influence?
Yes.
Amen. Number 10, do you believe that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit and that you are to honor God by caring for your body, by avoiding the use of that which is harmful, abstaining from all unclean foods, from the use, manufacture, or sale of alcoholic beverages, tobacco, and from the misuse of or trafficking in narcotics or other drugs?
Yes.
Number 11, do you know and understand the fundamental Bible principles as taught by the Seventh-day Adventist Church? Is it your purpose, by God's grace, to order your life in harmony with these principles?
Yes.
Amen. Number 12, do you accept the New Testament teaching of baptism by immersion, and do you desire to be so baptized today as a public expression of your faith in Christ and in the forgiveness of your sins?
Yes.
Amen. And number 13, do you believe that the faith exemplified by the Seventh-day Adventist Church is the remnant faith of Bible prophecy? And do you believe that people of every nation, race, and language are invited and accepted into its fellowship? Do you desire to have membership in this local congregation and in the world church?
Yes.
Amen. Praise the Lord, dear brothers and sisters, for these eternal principles boiled down into these vows. At this time, we'll step into the back rooms and we'll get into our robes and we will come into the waters here shortly. God bless you. Well, dear church family, we've come to this all-important time in Amanda's life where she gives her life to Jesus. It's really not her that's chosen Jesus, but it's Jesus that's chosen her. We joyfully respond, and Amanda, because you have decided to make Lord God, the Lord of your life, and He wants to take you to heaven, it's my pleasure to baptize you. So come right here. Yeah. And Amanda, because you love God, because you want Jesus to be your eternal Savior, it's now my pleasure to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. Amen.
Amen.
Such an important time for Robert and Miranda. This is an important step in their journey, having fallen in love, having gotten married, having a child on the way, and giving their lives to Jesus. I cannot think of a more beautiful picture and a more bright future that these three have before them. So Robert, because you've chosen Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, it is my pleasure to baptize you now. Robert, because you love Jesus, because you have accepted his invitation to be your Lord and Master for this life and for eternity, it's my pleasure to baptize you now in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God bless you, Miranda. They've been looking down on you, considering you his daughter for all these years, and now you're acknowledging him as your forever daughter. Miranda, because you love Jesus, because you affirm him as your Lord and your Savior, it is my pleasure to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Well, dear brothers and sisters, it's always a joy to welcome people officially into the kingdom of God and into the local church. If you yourself have been feeling the attracting power of Jesus, do not delay. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Myself, Pastor Nathaniel, and all the elders are always available to lead in personal Bible studies leading to baptism. And of course, the learning doesn't end there. It continues going deeper and wider and broader, full of joy for eternal life. God bless you all.
Our scripture reading is from John chapter 14, verses 15, 16, and 26. If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, and he may abide with you forever. But the helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all the things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. May God bless the hearing, understanding, and doing of his word. Amen.
We thank you once again for worshiping with us this Sabbath. We pray that the service so far has been a blessing. I want to thank again those who came out to help participate, Jonathan Mia and Joanne Lightford, and also Victor and Alina Tolan. Thank you so much for your contributions, and this church is full and vibrant because of your dedication. As you may know, my wife and I have two small children. What a joy it is watching them grow and learn. One of the neat things about parenting is that you get to observe and watch your kids go through stages of growth and learning that we have long since forgotten about ourselves. Let me ask you, a little show of hands here from home. How many of you remember learning to walk? Any of you? How about this one, learning to tie your shoes? Maybe a few of us remember learning to tie our shoes. Here's this next one. What about learning to ride a bike? Do you remember that? I have vague memories of learning to ride a bike as a kid. But I ask you, what unifies all these stages of learning? And everything in childhood, from feeding oneself, to learning to use the bathroom oneself, to getting oneself dressed, what is the common thread? We need help. We can't do it on our own. Parents have to do it 50 times, 75 times, 100 times for the kid and then with the kid before the kid can start doing it on their own. We are called children of God, and we are growing up in our development with him as our benevolent Father. How does God relate to us as children? Does God say, "There's the bar, jump it," or "There are the standards, achieve them," or "There's an obstacle, overcome it. I'll be waiting for you here on the other side. I hope you make it, but let's see if you sink or swim."
Is that God's attitude toward us? No! And thankfully and entirely, no! That's part of why the illustration of God as a loving parent is so beneficial to us, because caring help throughout the journey is heavily implied. Today's main Bible story is found in Mark chapter 9. I encourage you to open with me in your Bibles there. Mark chapter 9. This is just after Jesus has experienced his glorious transfiguration on the mount. And in fact, this is the first story afterwards. We're going to be reading verses 17 through 27 of Mark chapter 9. I'm reading in the New King James Version here. It reads like this. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, I have brought you my son who has a mute spirit. And whenever it seizes him, it throws him down, and he foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. So I spoke to your disciples that they should cast it out, but they could not." Jesus answered him and said, "O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me." Then they brought him to Jesus. And when he saw Jesus, immediately the spirit convulsed him, and he fell to the ground and wallowed, foaming at the mouth. So Jesus asked his father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "Since childhood. And often he has been thrown both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." Jesus said, "If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes." Immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe. Help me in my unbelief." When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "Deaf and dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him and enter him no more." Then the spirit cried out, convulsed him greatly, and came out of him. And he lay there as one dead, so that many said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him, and he arose. So that is a powerful story. That is a gripping story. Could you imagine witnessing that with your own eyes? This is a detailed story, surprisingly detailed, especially for the Gospel of Mark, which tends to be very brief. The crux, the key verse that I want to focus on today is that verse 24, where the father of the demon-possessed child cries out with tears, "Lord, I believe. Help me in my unbelief." Now, I'll confess something to you. This story and Jesus' reaction to that confession didn't sit well with me for a long time. Here, the father is expressing his vulnerability before Jesus. He's asking Jesus for help. And Jesus seems to be more reacting to the crowd rushing in and quickly doing the miracle rather than answering the father. We actually never hear from Jesus' lips what Jesus thinks of what the father says. I find myself identifying with the father in his weakness. I have some belief. I have a great desire to believe. Lord, please help me to come to a fuller belief. Help me in the portions of my life that are filled with unbelief. And for the longest time, I didn't know what to do with this passage, and it didn't sit well with me for some time. Well, I praise the Lord today because some time ago, I was reading the book Desire of Ages. Desire of Ages is the beautiful book that reflects on Jesus' ministry and expands on it a bit, giving us some historical and some cultural context. And on page 429 of the Desire of Ages, Sister White tells us this. "Cast yourself at the feet of Jesus with the cry, 'Lord, I believe. Help me in my unbelief.' You can never perish while you do this. Never." Isn't that so heartening, dear friends, to hear that advice? I'm actually going to back up and read the whole paragraph so that we can get that statement in the context of the paragraph. Sister White says this, again in Desire of Ages, page 429. "Let these people, in their helpless unworthiness, cast themselves upon the mercy of their compassionate Savior. Look not to self, but to Christ. He who healed the sick and cast out demons when he walked among men is the same mighty Redeemer today. Faith comes by the word of God. Then grasp his promise. 'He that comes to me, I will in no way cast out.' John 6:37. Cast yourself at the feet of Jesus with this cry, Lord, I believe, help me in my unbelief. You can never perish while you do this, never. Isn't that so encouraging, friends? I praise the Lord because that passage alleviated my anxiety over how I could approach Jesus. He wants to help us, and our admitting our need of help to Him is guaranteed to be answered with help. Praise the Lord, this father, even though he was struggling in his faith, got what he had been yearning for so long. He got it that day from Jesus. Similarly, we can cry out to Jesus, Lord, help us in our... And you can fill in the blank for yourself there. Help us in our temptations, Lord, in our tendencies to backslide. Help us, Lord, in our lack of love for each other. Give us your view of humanity. Help us, Lord, in our lukewarmness, in our desire to be merely comfortable. Help us out of that, Lord, we ask sincerely. The Spirit of Prophecy's counsel, you can never perish while you do this, while you pray this prayer. Never. I pray that we take that encouragement and store it deep in our hearts, friends. Amen. Our second main passage today is where we had our scripture reading from earlier. Thank you again, Sister Alina, for having read that for us. In John chapters 14 through 16, we have Jesus' final discourse with the disciples before he's going to go to the cross to be crucified. Now, in hearing this, the disciples were understandably sad because Jesus was telling them he was leaving. He wasn't going to be with them anymore. But Jesus tries to reorient their thinking by saying, "It is for your good that I am going away, because unless I go away, my Father cannot send the Holy Spirit to you." That's in John 16, verse 7. And Jesus goes on to describe many of the things, the functions that the Holy Spirit will do for the believers. He will remind them of Jesus' words. He will convict people's hearts. He will testify of Jesus. He will guard the believers in truth. But to me, perhaps the most significant thing about Jesus' discourse here is what he calls the Holy Spirit. Did you notice it in the scripture reading? He calls the Holy Spirit a helper. Think of that, friends. God the Father sends a powerful agent, part of God's own Trinity, to help us, to aid us in our need, to encourage us in our despair, to lift us up and to carry us through. Different Bible translations translate the term Jesus used here differently. It's a Greek word with significant semantic range in it. The word is parakleton. But drink in these other translations of the Greek word parakleton. Comforter, counselor, advocate. Don't we need all of these things, friends? Isn't it such an encouragement that God wants to help us along the path of faith? Not just say, there are the standards, achieve them. Think of the Holy Spirit helping you to do the spiritual equivalent of learning to ride a two-wheel bicycle, as we talked about earlier. It must seem impossible to a kid at first, right? Balancing on two wheels? What a feat! Until all of a sudden, after much help and after much practice, those neurons start connecting in the way they're supposed to, the muscles are doing what they were designed to do, and all of a sudden the kid is doing it, riding the bike with two wheels. We had that feeling with my son earlier in this quarantine period. You're doing it, you're riding that bike, and in a spiritual sense, you're doing it, you're bearing that spiritual fruit. And the Holy Spirit is overjoyed to see you learning under His care and His help. His smile is as broad as a proud father watching his son balance and pedal. And He continues to care and help throughout to the next task and the next. Tying the shoes, making the bed, things that all boys and girls learn to do. Obviously, for we as Christians, the spiritual equivalents, deepening in the Word, growing in love and service to God and to others, things that all Christians learn to do. As we begin to conclude today, there is a very telling image in the book of Revelation, and it has to do with the redeemed ones casting their crowns at the feet of Jesus. What does that mean? When we get to heaven, we receive a crown of glory. Praise the Lord. Many Bible chapters and Bible epistles affirm this. James 1:12, 1 Peter 5:4. But imagine, friends, when we look at that crown, when we feel its weight on our heads, will we have a sense of self-satisfaction? Like, hey, we did it! I did it! No, not in the least. We will see that crown, see it upon our brows, feel the weight on our heads, and think, this doesn't rightly pertain to me, to anything I've done. The Lord did it all. The Lord has brought me through. This is really His crown. And it will bring us great joy to remove those crowns that Jesus has placed on our brow and cast them back to the throne at the Lord's feet, saying, the glory is yours. You have done it in us. I love that image, friends. To God be all the glory. He has done it, and we have simply permitted Him to do it in us. I pray that you will extend your arm, that you will grasp His helpful grip, and that you will accept His help, receive His encouragement, His mercy, and His grace. I pray that you will find your salvation in the Lord, and that you will rejoice in the helpfulness that He gives you. As Psalm 46, verse 1 says, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in time of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the oceans roar and foam, though the mountains cast and surge, we will not fear. May that be your experience with God today and going forward. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for your promise of help through the Holy Spirit. We do not have to do it on our own. You help us on so many levels. With your word as a guiding light, with this community of faith as a source of friendship and support, and with your Spirit whispering to our hearts remembrances of Bible promises and Jesus' own words and power. Lord, help us live in and reflect your light. Help us to be your faith community. Help us to live authentically in this vague and difficult time. Help us to be guided by compassion, by mercy, by love in all things. And help us to fulfill all that you would have us be in this generation. Thank you for the promise, dear Heavenly Father, from the Spirit of prophecy that we cannot die while we are sincerely asking you for help. We pray all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
For our closing hymn, we're going to be singing number 353, Father, Help Your People, to the tune of My Jesus, I Love Thee. We'll sing all four stanzas.
Strengthen, Lord.
this joyful baptismal service, we want to, in a sense, express an apology for not making this an open invitation to the entire church, but you know that with COVID prevention guidelines, we're needing to keep our numbers to a very minimum. We are sorry in your sakes, because we usually like to have a potluck lunch and everything to celebrate your new arrival as members of the church, but thank you for giving us a spark of joy in the midst of an otherwise difficult time. We want to give a few things to express our appreciation today for you joining our church. Our real goal is to make your hands so full that you can hardly walk out of the building. So we're going to start with some certificates. These are some certificates to commemorate the day of your baptism, in case you ever forget the date or in case you ever need to give a recommendation to a boss. I am a trustworthy person. Look, here's my baptismal certificate. But this is a way to commemorate this beautiful day. So we hope this will beautify your home. Miranda, it says this certificate commemorates that Miranda Catherine Hance was baptized into Jesus and the local church membership at the Anaheim Seventh-day Adventist Church on August 8th, 2020. We have a similar one here for Robert. Congratulations, Robert, on your big step of faith. And also Amanda. We've got a Bible verse on there. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Praise the Lord. We've also got some smaller booklets to commemorate the day. These are signed by our church clerk, and they remind of the date and the place. These booklets have the 28 fundamental beliefs in them. They're kind of a quick reference if you ever need to look them up, and it's got the biblical citations. It's also got the 13 baptismal vows that you committed to. So we've got one for Amanda here. Congratulations, Amanda. And then one for Miranda and Robin. Congratulations again. We also have a couple other things that we want to give to you. First of all, we want to give each of you a Bible. We want to be facilitating your spiritual walk. And so, Amanda, for you, we're gifting you the Transformation Study Bible. This is the New Living Translation, which is a wonderful devotional translation. And we pray that as you read it and as you look at some of the supplemental materials, that your life will be transformed into loving Jesus more and more. So take that as a gift from us. Yeah. Similarly, Robert and Miranda, as you are recently married, we want to gift you with what's called the Couples Bible. It's got special devotions in it specifically for couples. So we really pray that as your relationship with the Lord grows, also your commitment to each other, your love for each other will be deepening and broadening as well. So got a little pamphlet in there with some principles, Bible principles for happy marriage. God bless you. Love the family. It's nice for some devotional times together. We're not done. We want to be edifying to an even greater degree. We have a copy of the book, The Great Controversy, for Sister Amanda. We sense that both the Lord and Satan are in a struggle over us, over our souls, because we are so dear to God. This book will enlighten how God has worked through history, how he has brought the church through, how he has brought the Bible through, and you are the latest victory on God's side in The Great Controversy. We pray that this will provide inspiration for you and also give you a sense of where you fit into God's plan. Yes. Similarly, another book that will help us fall in love and deepen with Jesus Christ, The Desire of Ages, the great magnum opus on the life of Jesus. This book is such a blessing. It fills out many details in the four Gospels. I sometimes read the four Gospels, and then I go and I read the corresponding chapter in here, and I say, is that really there in the Gospels? And I go back and look, and sometimes there's two or three words in the Gospels that gives a hint, and this explains it, unwraps it, and makes it such a fuller experience. So we pray that this will enhance your relationship with Jesus, that he would also be the desire of your heart. And one more thing, we know that you have a precious little one on the way, and so we have a book called The First 7 Years, Raising a Child to be a Responsible, Godly Person. And I have to admit, I ordered this without seeing it. I didn't realize it was such like a textbook. It's like, it's a way to carry for the door. So if new parents have many questions, and a book this size definitely has the answers in there somewhere. But we pray that this will be a good reference for you to how to raise your children responsibly, happily. We want a home that is harmonious and, of course, giving glory to God. Amen. So there's that one for you. And if you aren't handling enough, we wanted to give one more thing that expresses just a dim reflection of the glory that you, the beauty that you bring us.
Thank you once again for worshiping with us today. Let's have a prayer of closure as we finish up. Dear Heavenly Father, as we go our separate ways, as we prepare to face a new week in your love and your care, we pray that we would be guided at each step by your helpful Holy Spirit. Help us to remember, Lord, that we can turn to you at any time. We needn't fear, we needn't stress. We can simply pray to you for wisdom, for guidance on how to act in the given situation. Please, dear Heavenly Father, bless our church communities. Keep us protected, keep us safe, keep us healthy. And please, Lord, help those who are working so hard on the front lines of danger and difficulty. The doctors and nurses, of course, dear Lord, battling COVID and helping treat patients. The firefighters facing heat and danger, and also those recovering from the hurricane a couple of days ago. Lord, we know that beyond all those factors, we've all got our own needs. It's so much, dear Lord, but you cannot be overwhelmed. We entrust you with it. We are confident that you can handle it, and we dedicate ourselves to you this Sabbath and into our new week. Thank you for each church member, each family watching here today. We pray we will continue to walk in the light of your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
What I had heard was, Justin, you're not good enough. You know, you're not good enough to be calling yourself a Christian. You're not good enough for God. Church wasn't real. God wasn't real to me. It was a place that we would go every single weekend, but it didn't really actually impact my life. And so very quickly, I decided this isn't something that I'm going to pursue my life with anymore. But that all changed for me my senior year of high school when I ran into a group of other young people, like in their late teens, early 20s, who were actually living an authentic and real expression of Christianity. And they were opening up the Bible and showing that the Bible had real answers to the real questions and dilemmas that I was facing. For me, I'm committed to use things like social media and technology to spread the message. I believe that technology is one of the best ways that we can actually spread the gospel. And so why am I a steward? Because God is real.